I'm Jason, this is Aya, and we work collaboratively under the name Overture for about 10 years now. We do mostly animation, but we also do a lot of illustrations and design and some performance work. We wanted to share some of our work with you today and also kind of talk about some of our process and how we make things, because our work is very collaborative. Everything we do is the two of us. So we thought, we've never done this before. We've never done, what I'm going to talk about next, we've never shared with anyone before in a public setting. But we wanted to start kind of where we started, where Overture started, because there's a core kind of essence of what we do in our kind of origin story. And we started in Oktama, which is, it's part of Tokyo.
Part of Tokyo.
It's all this like very mountainous, wooded area. And we went on a camping trip with friends to these cabins. So we went deep into the woods down by this little river, and there's cabins. And we knew each other, we were friends, but we had never really talked that much. But we started talking, and I think we were talking about maybe like Mayan calendar or something. Something that kind of sparked our interest. And we stayed up all night in this one cabin by ourselves drawing. And we were drawing what's called exquisite corpses. Has anyone done those? Yes, they're very nice. They get you kind of out of your rational mind. And we kind of did a version of it where I think a lot of times when it's drawing, people can start with like a body shape and draw the different body parts. But we were doing these very crude, these are some of the drawings that we did, very crude, with markers that we had, just anything. Like one person would start doing whatever they wanted and, you know, fold the paper, have a little bit of the lines show, and then the next person would just go wherever they wanted. I think this one we even started folding the paper in
eight different pieces.
And this kind of broke for us into two different kind of fields, or it kind of evolved for us in two different ways. One way, which you'll see in some later slides, is kind of the illustration end of it, where we kind of took this and stopped hiding what we were drawing from each other, but kind of just built together on top of it, kind of just started drawing together and kind of circumventing or cutting off what the other person was doing, or sometimes kind of like trying to interpret what they were trying to do. The other thing was with storytelling. So on this left-hand one, you can kind of see like these legs that end that are connected with like this weird bumpy body. We were thinking, gosh, that kind of, I don't know why, but it looks like an intestines or a large intestines with legs or something. So we created this story same night, this totally ridiculous story about these intestine brothers. They were three brothers. There were originally four, but there's three brothers now who are all in varying degrees of intelligence. Basically, the story goes that one of the brothers was killed by accident by this man on the left in the purple, and as payback, or as kind of to make amends, he's feeding one of the brothers hamburger once a week to make amends. And you can see he's this brother, he loves hamburgers. He's drooling at the thought of going to eat hamburgers. And his other brothers, who are less intelligent, try and tag along. And this one, who's a little bit less intelligent, he's drooling as well. And the other one is just so beyond thinking that, I don't know, he's just falling from the sky. I have no idea, really, what's going on here anymore. But we just came up with this ridiculous story on the fly that evening, drew it up, made us laugh, but there's also some sort of like pathos. There's kind of a sadness to it. These stupid intestines brothers. I don't know. It's very ridiculous. But this sort of we felt like this is kind of like the core of what we do. We're always trying to search together for this kind of elation and weird, happy but sort of like sad essence. So after this, we started drawing more together, illustrations at first, but we had both been doing a little bit of animation, so we decided to try and do some animation together. So we made our first sort of short that we actually wanted to make into a larger piece, but it was for this little exhibition. We didn't have a lot of time, so we made this very short that kind of combined these two worlds that we had at the time. that was like the first time that we were like, can we do this? Will this work? And I think we were just so excited to have done something that looked like it actually was animated that we were like, yes, it can work.
And yeah, but we have no idea how to make animation, so we just hand drawn.
Yeah, we hadn't really made traditional. We had definitely done a lot of some animation that was, moving assets around, sort of like stop motion with digital assets that you move frame by frame. But this is the first kind of traditional cell sort of hand drawn animation that we made. And we're very interested in the getting out of ourselves or getting out of our egos onto some touching on something that was greater than what we could create individually. And definitely with that first sort of like intestines brothers story, we realized we could hit these points that individually we couldn't necessarily hit. And both of us before doing this, or before working together, we never thought we could collaborate with somebody on something or work openly with someone. But just looking at what the potential was, we realized we had to pursue this and see how far we could go with it. So, and a lot of the work we try and do, it takes a long time, obviously, to make animation, months, if not longer. But we try, the initial inspiration, we try to do, pull something that's personal or immediate or environmentally local to us. And this one, we were living in Tokyo and we felt like we were kind of in a desert situation, kind of like lost in the desert, sort of, even though Tokyo is basically a swamp.
Also sometimes Japanese call Tokyo as desert, Tokyo desert, like maybe cynical or like a nothing.
A lot of concrete,
there.
I guess, yeah. Mm. So anyway, that was, and we had been working on the story. It's like this other story, this bigger story that we kind of pieced out in an exhibition, but that was the first sort of like short animation that we created. So after that, we came to the States, we moved to the States, and we were immediately inspired by, New England, Western Mass sort of forests and greenery and the lushness of everything that's happening here. And that was in 2006, 2007, when we moved back. And we had this offer from this Icelandic band called Moom to make a video. We always look at that we have a story or we have a number of stories that we want to be telling, and we have an opportunity to expose that story to like a wider audience. And definitely doing something in a music video format has always provided us with like a wider reach than if we were just submitting to festivals or putting something online. And a lot of our work is music video or kind of music based, you'll see, but this one was like a very standard music video. We did that one in 2007, and the next one I'll show you was after that. We went to a show of Mooms, the Icelandic band's show, and we met a German artist there, Volker Bertelmann, who plays under the name Hauschka. And he really wanted to work with us and wanted to score something of ours. And we didn't have anything. We don't usually just make work. we have stories, but we usually need some sort of impetus to actually start making them. So we worked with him. We told him a story we wanted to do, and he wanted to make a three-part animation, he wanted to give us three songs basically that we could use. So we made a three-part animation. We were still very enchanted by the area here, so we wanted to do something that was, again, very kind of lush and forested. And we were very, before we even talked with him, we were interested in telling some sort of Aesop fable sort of story, or in some degree, about the sun and the north wind. We really wanted to get that out somehow, in some fashion. So we created this story about these two monsters or creatures in this woods and kind of what their interaction is. And it has a lot to do with like collaboration and whatnot. It's a little bit longer, it's a three-piece. Was Hauschka, the musician, he plays what's called a prepared piano. I think maybe John Cage or someone started this process. There was definitely in the very last piece and the pieces before it, there's some strings, like a cello or something, and definitely some like brass or something at the very end. But everything else is just him at the piano, and what he does is he attaches different things to the strings. So like, he'll take tape and a little toy, like a plastic toy, or put a ping pong ball, or
coins,
bolts. Yeah, any like little different things. And when he hits when he's playing the piano, the strings vibrate, or the hammers hit the strings, and they also move the little pieces or toss the ping pong ball around. And he has those he picks those up with mics, and it creates all these kind of percussive sounds. And it's really amazing, especially when you see him play live. It's like how. Yeah, it's like all these kind of like, I don't know, snare and hi-hat sort of sounds and stuff that happen, and I don't know how he plans for any of it, but he does. So yeah, so that was a bigger project for us.
It takes 1 year.
About a year, from 2008 to middle of 2009.
For 14 minute animation.
We were working on other things at the time. One of the things that we were working on was album covers. We were doing a few album covers at the time. And this one in particular, for another Icelandic musician, Kira Kira, ended up kind of bringing us back to those initial roots of the Exquisite Corpse. So the album's called Our Map to the Monster Olympics. So there's some sort of Monster Olympics, apparently, and there's a map that's the focus of the album. And so for the liner notes, we created this large fold-out piece of paper, which, you know, loosely interpreted as a map. On the other side was the track listing, and each section of the map corresponds to a track on the album. And so we would just listen to a track and draw whatever came to mind for that particular section. It was very kind of freeform, and we'd basically just draw, we take turns drawing in spaces. Certain spaces, like Aya might start drawing this, and then I would finish with other parts of the body, or I would draw something on top of it, and it's just one, basically just one big piece of paper that we scanned in parts and put together. So it's just like a ink illustration. But after we made it, we made this in 2009, and then in 2010, we started talking about doing an animation with one of her tracks, and we thought the best or an interesting way to do this would be to look at the track, look at the illustration that we did for the track, and I mean, the illustration was completely improvised.
Yeah, we didn't plan to make illustration as story for music video.
No story thought of or anything, but we decided to go back to the illustration that we improvised and find what the story was and then create an animation based on that. So this left-hand section is what the track was for, or the illustration for the track. And
start with this guy.
Reading. Start with this reading guy with a weird head with eyeballs.
Thank you.
I don't know if you saw on the last illustration the characters and stuff, but a lot of those showed up in the, or all of them showed up in the animation, and the story was pulled from that. So at the same time, in 2010, we started doing, we wanted to do more interaction with people. We wanted to try and do kind of more, somehow do like live performance sort of stuff. We just loved, our animations get to go to different places, but we always can't afford to go somewhere, or, you know, we can't always go everywhere that our work goes. But every time we can see someone watching an animation, reacting to it, or an audience, it's always such a great feeling. So we wanted to do something where we could actually kind of interact with people more. So we started doing kind of performances. We did this thing called storytelling, or storytellers, where we would kind of tell a story with images and almost like picture book reading, and incorporate animation into that. So kind of basically bed the animations in kind of a story. And we also did live scoring, where we invited a musician to play new music to an animation to kind of give it a new feel. And then we also did a lot of live drawing, where we would, again, team up with a musician of some kind, an artist, and we would draw or paint in response to what they were doing. And a lot of time, or as much as we could, we would start the performances off with a little workshop where we would do mask making. And the masks were, depending on who we were working with, every performance was like a different sort of audience. Sometimes it was kids, sometimes it was all adults, sometimes it was a mix, and depending on what the age group was, or who kind of the interested party was, the audience was, how they made the masks, what they ended up being, varied. But they were always a lot of fun, and allowed people to kind of more, we were trying to look for ways to allow people to kind of more honestly approach an event or participation. So we figured if people had masks, they would feel less inhibited potentially to laugh or
process of making masks. Like if you're focusing on, maybe you worked 8 hours in a day and you got a ticket and okay, let's go. But you still have some work or busy atmosphere around you. And we really want, if we could do, we really want to make big bathtub and okay, get in here. And take your time and wash your body and take, it's your after bath time, watch this animation. But we can't make it. So we try to make, how can we make cheap, quick, easy one?
Drop there.
Like at least
worries.
You focus on making mask, and maybe we hope you a little bit forget about what you've done for a whole day. So we decided, because color paper, we can find anywhere, like a scissors or tape.
Yeah, really simple yeah. Things, simple masks.
Yeah, around my hometown, it was kids. And this is Tokyo, lots of adults.
In 2011, there was a big earthquake in Japan, which I'm sure you've all have heard about, and all these different terrible things that happened afterwards. The mask making thing kind of struck a chord with kind of a desire to somehow respond to that event. So we made an animation with a musician in Japan that kind of took the concepts of the masks and funneled that into an animation. The animation is called Halfway.
Thank you.
twinkling, circling, shining stars seem to be my home. You stare up the sky, reach out for the stars.
That was very different for us, but it definitely, having the outside, the physical kind of performance thing kind of inform our work was kind of a new and like interesting thing for us to do, right? And during, also during that time when we started doing the mask making in 2010, we had already, we did a tour in Japan, a record label tour sponsored us to do a tour. And we were doing the mask making and the live drawing and the live scoring, and we had already had a separate, not the halfway animation, but a separate piece that we wanted to make, and it takes so long to make an animation, and a lot of times it takes even longer to get to the point when you can start making the animation, that we a lot of times try and fill up the time until we can start making, so we create alternate stories or additional stories that can kind of help flesh out the world of the single animation that we're making. And the next animation that we're going to show, we were on a camping trip in 2010, or maybe 2009, and we it was dusk, and we were looking out over like this body of water, and on the other side there was like a light from a cabin or a house or something, and we started talking about humans, or like the playfulness in humanity, and how humans love to play or go on these kind of go to the edge of danger, or in competition in like daily life, you know, compete either in work setting or life setting or play setting. You know, you humans like to go to the edge of danger and have that without that opportunity to either die or fail.
Like rock climbing.
Rock climbing. Or camping.
Camping, eventually. Yeah. In that moment, like we are watching a fire, and it, like if you do this, it could burn your skin. But we love to watching a fire. And why we like this? Yeah.
So we wanted to do a story that kind of looked at that. But we had it was we didn't end up making the animation until 2012. But for the tour that we did in 2010, there's this one sort of character that kind of appears in the animation, and we kind of created this myth or this kind of folk story about this character, and made a series of large watercolor illustrations that we took on the tour with us, and you know, displayed in different spaces that we were in, and talked about, and kind of talked up the animation that we were going to do. It's about this large rabbit or hare that we call the moon hare, and it's the story of how it loses its ears, it becomes an earless hare, but it gets the power of the moon in return. So after we did this, we still have this. It's traveled, it's gone to different exhibits. But when we finally started making the animation, it's called Ludic Chase, we had an offer to do a promotional sort of video for this nonprofit online radio station that we really love called dublab. And we wanted to somehow include some of the characters that were in the Ludic Chase, kind of mix them together. We already had all of kind of the background elements, all of the scenery, the forest scenery.
This is the one character from Ludic Chase, and you're talking about like a really short animation for dublab.
Yeah.
We used like kind of this background, part of background.
Part of it. And it was, you know, we went camping. The inspiration was this camping trip that we had taken, which again was pretty local to the area, and again the scenery, the plant life was all inspired by the area around here, and so we wanted to keep that sort of true in this short for dublab, this promo video for dublab. And at the time we were very interested, and still are, but we were really getting interested to like wildcrafting and mushroom hunting, and kind of finding foraging for things in the forest that were just growing naturally. And we did a short promo about that, and we kind of thought it was semi-analogous to, I don't know, like record hunting or you know, playing music on a radio station. But it's very short, and then after that we'll go into Ludic Chase, which is the piece that we finally finished after that. So we'll just go right into the Ludic Chase, because it kind of plays off of this.
Thank you.
Yeah, so that was Ludic Chase, 2012. We were thinking of showing one more animation that we finished earlier this year. There's been, I mean, we're always working on kind of commercial stuff in addition to stuff that's kind of more our pet projects. And this one's kind of both, the next one we're going to show you. And basically, it, again, came from inspiration that we already had. We went on a trip this spring to the West Coast and for a festival, and we took a bunch of video while we were driving up. We drove up the coast and stopped in Big Sur area and took a bunch of video there, and just for fun. I mean, we just wanted to take video. And then we had this opportunity from an artist that wanted to work with us, and we thought it'd be a great opportunity to make use of all this video that we took that has to do with the ocean. We were thinking a lot about the ocean and how it's kind of like this big womb, birthplace sort of thing. So we'll show that, and then we'll talk about some more recent stuff that's kind of coming to fruition.
She backs to tide out, set me down, but she looks so fine. Tied up, it's setting me down because she's so fun. Well, he's tied on the whole. Oh, 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 oh. Well, he's tied on the whole. Oh, 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 oh. He just made up, wanna take you around. Nobody just wanna save the spot. You know I need your love. Oh, it's a baby life, a life to love. So great.
So now we're going to talk about a couple things that are kind of coming out right now that we've been working on. This is pop-up book with embedded LEDs, and there's also an album associated with it. We only did the artwork for it. We didn't do the story, but we did it in about 2 years. It took us about 2 years to bring it all to fruition. It's very, very involved, a lot of layers and things. It's a quick video. I don't think we need to... Yeah, we don't need to dim the lights for it. Elaborate book. The CD has, so each track corresponds to a page in the book, and there are high frequency sounds on each track that the book picks up, and the LEDs light up to different parts of the music. It's very impressive.
The
LEDs are embedded in like this fabric that's in between the pop-up pages, so you can see there's like a woman with her eyes were glowing and things, and the trees with the lights glowing in the trees. So it's most that's all beyond me. We just did the artwork, but we're very happy and excited to be a part of that. That just came out last Friday, so it just became available last Friday online and in various stores in Japan. In conjunction with that, we had an opportunity to have an exhibition part of this festival in this town in southern Japan where they gave us this entire house that had been renovated into a gallery to show our work, and we used the second floor to focus on the pop-up book. And instead of just having the pop-up book alone, which was ready at the time, we also printed out the layers of the pop-up book and then put them onto plexiglass and hung them from the ceiling. So you can kind of see there's a little bit of sense of depth to the images. So that was nice. We weren't actually there to see this hung. We just sent everything. We cut everything and sent it. But yeah, and the book is there on the desk, and then they had some color templates or color palettes that we had created for it. And then, so that then that exhibition just ended this past weekend as well, so things are wrapping up. And this is something we've been working on for a while, Weird Healing. It's these two characters. They travel all over the place, all over the universes, healing people, or healing things with very unconventional means. We originally created a pitch for a animated series for using these guys that so far has not been picked up, but we were asked to create a short for a film festival or an animation festival, and so we have one very short sort of, not quite pilot, but proof of concept sort of short that we created that has been going to festivals. We've also been creating short little comic strips for a local newspaper, the Montague Reporter, that's been coming out once every 2 weeks or once every 3 weeks, depending on what their schedule is like. It changes sometimes. They're about 6 panels long usually, and no words. And again, you can just kind of let the visuals wash over you, or try and figure out what's going on. But sort of the stuff that we enjoy doing. Definitely check out the Montague Reporter for
yes, please
more weird healing stories.
Well, I'm conscientious that this has been a long
yes,
presentation,
sorry.
And you must be hungry. But I'm sure if you want to stick around and ask questions, Jason and I would be happy to. But so thank you so much for this.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.